And welcome back. Yeah.
Got it.
I'm getting the hell out of here. Heading for the White March. Yeah, don't stop now. Keep going. We fought our way through all this crap. Still got that cave. I'm not gonna mess with that. Most of the time, what's in the cave is, tougher than what's outside. Gotta get another couple, camping supplies and then we'll be on our way. Alright, let me pay the... Sagani's been on that adventure for a long time. Let's see. We still have the Woodland Trails bonus, so let's just get our two camping supplies, because this is on a big trip. Who knows when we're gonna have camping supplies again. I mean, I assume there's some major town or city that we're going to, but I don't know what we have to fight through to get there. Alright. Boop, boop, ba-doop.
Hello.
Hello, hello. Why did I put that on the bottom? You know it's what we want most. We have four. Those battles are really tough. My god. I was hoping we're a little easier this time. White March. Okay, so we go right to this? What was that? Missing maps 175. That's interesting. I guess we're going to this Stalwart village. 24 hours. Oh yeah, I heard about this. Your party is considered high level for the content in the White March. If you would like, the critical path can be increased in difficulty to give you more of a challenge. The rewards you receive will be the same regardless of the option you choose. Your choice cannot be changed once it has been selected. Let's go high level, why the hell not? Wait, is that going to get rid of two of our camping supplies? I think two... One of the higher levels, you can't have as many camping supplies. Let's see.
You set out for Stalwart. The White March rises up in the distance, stretching to the north and south as far as the eye can see. It beckons to you with peaks like broken fingers. The road thins to a tattered ribbon, and the shadow of the mountains falls across your path. You've barely begun your climb when the darkening sky pummels you with hailstones and turns the ground beneath you to ice. You press on. The air grows thin, and the treacherous mountain passes funnel screeching winds past your ears. A blizzard forces you to make camp for 3 days, huddling for safety while snow piles around your refuge. At last the weather clears, and you approach Stalwart under a crisp blue sky. There's a noise, high and sharp, coming from the village that sounds at first like another frozen gale. But when you top the rise and reach the village's wooden gates, you see what lies beyond them.
Sounds like we had a lot of fun getting there.
It's Darzir! With a whole pack of them!
We can take these bastards!
Oh, what the hell? Darzir, huh? Alright guys, help these guys. What are these Darzir things? Crag ogres. A crag ogre cannoneer. He's using a whole cannon thing. Did you kill them all already? I mean, I want to save them. This is like old school, like, danger theme. At least they present big targets. Were you running two Durants? Why is he running over there? What's this? Villager. Interdiction. Oh, he's almost dead. Nice. Knock him down. Here they are, the harder they fall. Ooh. Look how easy these guys are. See if we could save this villager. Oh no, we couldn't, damn it! Where should we go?
Sure.
Hmm. These smelters haven't seen use in a long time. Grab those ringer berries. Ringer bushes are extremely hardy and can be found even in the relatively barren upper reaches of the White March's mountains. The berries are extremely bitter and often cause sickness if ingested in any large quantity. Despite their toxicity, they are valuable to settlers for their ability to produce a vivid, color-fast red dye. We still have four, what do you call it? Camping supplies. Come on, chisel. The mine looks like it was deliberately collapsed. Interesting. Bloodstone. This guy who was standing here is dead now? Opal? Ah, there's one of them. Up quick.
Hey.
chunkage.
Following your lead.
4 moonstones.
Sure.
The door appears to be barred from the inside. It does not budge. Oh, this is a big area. Long watch falls. You know, we're taking advantage of all the chaos to help ourselves to some stuff. Ooh, a winter wolf. Awesome. I don't know what's all these traps.
I understand.
I think these guys have a lot of problems here.
Sure.
Species. Stalwart fishery. Barred from the inside, does not budge. Five tin hats. Tin hats can be difficult to spot in the snowy landscape of the White March. Those were a handy tab button is for. Featuring an off-white coloration tinged by golden brown edges, the small mushrooms are often hidden among the bottoms or along the bottoms of fallen birches. Stalwart locals often use them in cooking. Some bold individuals have used them to make an extremely potent tea, but varying reports on the brew claim it tastes vile and causes paralysis, hallucinations, and temporary blindness. Wow. One of them now. Oh, wow.
Something over there.
Come on, get up.
Love, Varu, be on seat!
Oh, you standing all the way back here, slacker? can help. Help us stop your, whatever, like a hell, your consecrated ground, just to chill out. Two moonstones. Speckleback jerky. +8 max endurance, +1 intellect and perception for 200 seconds. Speckleback fish are common in the cold waters flowing out of the White Marsh. Their lean meat makes them ideal for curing and drying for use as jerky. Deerwoodens often salt their jerky, but Stalwart locals cut specklebacks into thin strips and use smoke to cure them. Sounds yummy. Oh, look at that! We're breathing frost. That's awesome.
Got it.
More ringer berries and Britwin ban. These small fuzzy flowers glow in the cool climates of the White Marsh's foothills. Though the petals are white, their yellow and lavender centers stand out in their snowy home. Glamfellens sometimes journey from the forest to collect the flowers for use in special ceremonies. Stalwart locals learn the name from the friendliest members of the tribes. Friendlier members, actually. It's kind of hard to read. I'm just very distracted here with this music. But I'll forget otherwise. How many of them are there?
Wait.
Okay, stop. I guess blasts of frost wouldn't do much. I'm curious now. Of course, the Aeloth had to stand right in the way. Oh my god, our paladin's out. Seriously? Get me mad now. Did we cast this already? Go. Heal the guy. Thank you.
That's it.
Oh, it's Anna.
Lavaru, be on.
Tough, huh? No, pause. Oh, it's too late. Shit. Pardon my language, guys. Alright, never mind.
What?
War leader, Darzir. I don't know, that's why he's so tough.
Hey. Hey.
Keep hitting him. This clear out thing doesn't work on them.
Hey.
It did, actually. We just keep getting knocked over.
How may I?
That's it.
Hey.
Stop. That's it. Mowing your Ixie.
Far away. Sheesh, man. Yeah, I was a little sloppy. The fights are going pretty well until now. I didn't think we'd get trounced so hard. And I was surprised. This guy's almost dead.
Lava!
That's it!
Yay!
How may I?
Oh, we killed him. Just want to see. Oh, see, we still hit him for 70 freeze damage, so it's still a good spell. Nice.
Darzir's fallen. Back to the matron now.
Get the hell out of here. You know it's good for you. You! You're the one Renan Guild sent for. She'll want to speak with you. Her house is just up the way, next to the Greff's Rest. The messenger pants, waving smoke away from his face. Well, hey, we're almost, like, dead here, but thanks.
Katie's house is burning! Hurry! They're both in there!
Huh. Someone's house is burning. We should help them. Letters arrived. Yeah, Renning Guild has summoned me to her house. No doubt she has additional information about Durgan's battery and what I'll need to do to breach the keep.
Indeed.
Indeed.
Help! The hut's coming down!
What can we do? The roof of this hut is almost entirely enveloped in flames, lighting the snow in stark orange hues. Several beams have been reduced to ember-dotted husks. Through the hut's threshold, you can see only the billowing smoke. Fire roars as it climbs the timbers. The air feels thick and hot, and the building is a maze of flame. Withstanding the smoke and navigating the fire will be a challenge. Send it there. I always send him in these dangerous situations. Out of any of us, he's the most like an actual fireman, so... Adair leaps over the burning threshold, plunging out of sight behind a wall of smoke. Inside the house, fire has pitted the walls and beams, and a thick haze rolls through the building. It is hard to see even a few feet ahead, save for the occasional glimpse of glowing embers. Plus, out of any of us, he's the one who's most healthy. Yeah, let's crouch down to avoid the smoke. Adair moves onward through a haze of heat and soot. The hut groans and shifts as the blaze grows. With a mighty groan, the burning beam comes crashing down. Caught off guard, Adair is pinned beneath the heavy log. Push the beam away. Even reeling from the impact, Adair is still able to heave the debris away with relative ease. Adair gets upright, a little winded from the ordeal. This is Might 10. Go, Adair! A sudden flashover singes Adair's arms. It doesn't stop Adair, but the pain steadily grows. Pressing forward, Adair comes at last to a wider room. To the left is the man, the source of the faint cries for help. He stands trapped behind a curtain of flame, arms raised to ward off the heat. It may be impossible to reach him without quenching the fires first. To the right, a woman lies unconscious beneath what appears to have once been the roof. She's small, but the rubble trapping her looks heavy. Smoke winds its way up and out into the open air, obscuring all sight of the outside. To the left is a man. Well, it's impossible to reach him without quenching the fire, so let's look to the right where the woman is unconscious. The woman is trapped beneath a considerable amount of rubble, including a heavy crossbeam. A purpling bruise on her temple suggests that she was struck as the debris fell. Try to use the pry bar. Adair sets the pry bar against a section of the crossbeam and, using every ounce of strength, strains to lift it clear. After a period of fruitless struggle, the beam finally begins to rise by slow degrees. With one great and final effort, Adair heaves the last of the rubble clear of the woman. Though still unconscious, the woman is free of the rubble and can now be moved. Well, she's unconscious, so it doesn't make sense to just take the beams off of her and then turn away, so I guess we're carrying her out. Unfortunately, that means this man is doomed, I guess. The woman is of a slight frame, and carrying her proves easier than freeing her from the rubble. Adair hoists her carefully onto his shoulder. Okay, I thought we had to take her out. Okay, so we can put her over her shoulder and then help the man. It wasn't clear. Adair approaches the other victim. Smoke clogs Adair's lungs, and the heat has become unbearable. Adair will collapse soon. That's not good. Adair hears a shriek of pain. Adair can see but the faintest outline of the man as he collapses and writhes, engulfed by flames. Behind Adair, fire and smoke rise in front of the exit. Retreat! beset by smoke-clogged air, blistering heat, and burning debris, Adair is rapidly losing strength. With every passing moment, survival becomes more unlikely. Come on, Adair, get the hell out of there. Keeping a firm hold upon the unconscious woman, Adair turns for the exit. Adair clears the fallen beam with easy grace, avoiding the scattered embers and debris underfoot. The smoke clouds Adair's vision, but makes it difficult to breathe, but Adair struggles onward. Bleh, sorry guys. At last, Adair comes to the door, rushing out of the blaze and into the mountain air.
Katie, thank the gods you saved her.
Well, that's how you spell Katie. The villager says, I was sure that thing was coming down and taking your friend with it. The man wipes his brow and stares up at the collapsing house. At least you got Katie out when you did. As for poor Lurgolder, his eyes widen as a section of the roof collapses. He looks away, shaking his head. You look like you could use a drink. Take this over to Hafarix and have one on me. He flips you a couple flat, carved bones. We'll get the rest of these flames put out. Go on and have yourself a drink. That's awesome how they're coming around and doing that. Oh, okay. So we got Tana's house. Renengild's house. Did they mention? Durgan's battery comes out, lies outwards that way. The Greff's Rest. Stalwart Hot Springs. Edurin's Wagon. Thursek's house. Where is this bar they mentioned? Or this inn? I guess it's the Greff's Rest is what they're speaking about. I'm back. Trying to talk to you. That's awesome. They're running all the way for that. Gotta get that fire out. I like that. That's a nice touch. Ring of Changing Heart. Ooh, I like this theme. Very nice. Grants Dominate to Peres. That's pretty awesome. 3 Resolve. Plus 2 Resolve. Kelato, more commonly known as the Bronze Chanter, or simply Kai, was a famous singer and flautist from the old empire of Granvalia. His exploits with women were even more famous than his skill with music, and though he claimed that his way with women came from his innate charm, he was never seen without a certain silver ring, even when he had divested himself of all else. In the end, it was Kai's own indiscretions that led to his demise. He dallied with an assassin known as Faldilla Rugia, and then he comforted the niece of the woman's most recent mark. What was an unfortunate coincidence for Kai looked like a suspicious alliance to the assassin, and she killed him in his sleep to prevent him from spilling her secrets. Well, I do like this because we have a power with it. Well, here it says Major Spellbind. Oh, Dominate Major. Okay, never mind. Oh, that's right, we can have two rings, right? Gone's Pledge. Hmm. I love the suppress affliction. It's awesome. Well, what? We'll give it to him. I don't think the area of effect is that much difference for Canna. To Adra. Ogre blood. Complete fate potion. And wolf hide. Sorry, getting in your way. Alright guys, stay tuned for next episode when we explore Stalwart Village. Now that it's not being attacked by stuff. Thanks for watching, see you next time, and endure. Enduring, go strong.